Okay, so we are live now. Meeting is now live. Shall I start, sir?
Yeah, please start.
Throughout history, crises of different forms have challenged humanity. Some are political or economic, natural or social. How we interpret, react, and bounce back from the crisis of today will define how we survive the crisis of tomorrow. The human mind is supreme. We transform adversities into opportunities. Good afternoon, everyone. I, Shilpi Agarwal, take this privilege to welcome you all on behalf of Maharaja Agrasen Institute of Management Studies for the International Conference on Global Economic Order in the Post-COVID-19 Era, Challenges, Opportunities, Strategies, on this pleasant afternoon of 25th July 2020. I would also like to extend a hearty welcome to our founder chair, Dr. Nandkishore Garg, all honorary members of Managing Committee MAITS, Dr. S.K. Garg, Director General MAIMS, Dr. G.P. Govil, Advisor MAITS, Dr. Ravi Gupta, Director MAIMS. Looking at the paucity of time, though we would have loved to, but cannot have all of them, all the presenters live, but we would like to acknowledge and sincerely thank all of them for their contribution. Now I invite the conference convener, Dr. Sanjay Mangla, for the welcome address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Shilpi ma'am. And very good afternoon from India to all my friends in India as well as abroad. Dr. Gupta from Oman, and I can also see Dr. Sangeeta Tripathi from Oman. Welcome you, ma'am. Dr. Ajay Bamba, who is joining us from Rohtak, from BMU University. Welcome, sir. So I welcome all the dignitaries for this technical session. Our founder chair, Dr. Nandkishore Garji, all the honorary members of managing committee, Director General Professor S.K. Garg, Professor Govil, Advisor MAITS, our beloved Dr. Ravi Kumar Gupta, Director of MAIMS, all my colleagues, Dean of MAIMS, Dr. Sangeeta Malik, all the heads of the department, Dr. Praveen Gupta from Law, Dr. Manju Gupta from Commerce, and Dr. V.K. Khurana from Business Administration, and Dr. Vinita Gupta from Journalism and Mass Communication, and all my faculty colleagues, staff, dear students. So I welcome you all to this technical session 2 of this international conference on global economic order in the post-COVID-19 era, challenges, opportunities, and strategies. So we had a wonderful session, 2 sessions in the morning. One is introductory and another one is technical session, which was dedicated to students. And this session is particularly devoted for faculty members in India as well as abroad. So Dr. Gupta and Dr. Urvashi, it is my pleasure to inform you that we have received such an overwhelming response from participants for our conference. Though we announced this conference in just 1 month ago, and we could manage to get more than 220 research papers with more than 500 total participants. So I thank you all for showing your great interest and making this event success. I welcome you all again, once again. And Shilpi ma'am, please start. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Now I invite my senior fellow, Dr. Umesh Pathak, to please welcome the session chair and co-chair for this technical session. Here I would like to mention that the session chair and co-chair shall evaluate the presentations on pre-decided parameters and collaboratively judge the best paper award. Pathak sir, over to you, please.
Thank you, Shilpi ma'am. We are honored to have Professor Dr. S.L. Gupta as a session chair of this session. Professor S.L. Gupta is a professor and dean, Waljat College of Applied Sciences, Muscat, Oman. And Professor Gupta earned his PhD on a comparative study of performance and profitability of pharmaceutical industry in the NCR from Meerut University in 1998. Recently, he has also earned postdoctoral D.Litt in quality education from State Government University. Dr. Gupta has a rich experience of 27 years in academia. He has two his credit 8 books and several publications that are of national and international repute. He has professional life member in 7 associations and societies, and he is a versatile academic person, and he has worked for the government funded research projects, FDPs, and several training programs. We welcome you, sir, as a
thank
chair
you.
Of the session.
Thank you, Pathak ji.
Thank you, sir. And next we have our very own and associate professor, Department of Commerce, Delhi School of Economics, University of Delhi, Dr. Urvashi Sharma ji. Urvashi ma'am, we welcome you again in your ex-organization. And we have been a great association with you, and still we are happy to have you in this event as a co-chair of the session. Dr. Sharma earned her PhD from Jainarayan Vyas University, Jodhpur, Rajasthan, and she has more than 19 years of teaching experience and has worked in capacity of head of the department, BBA, NGGS, IP, university colleges, and she has recognized many international conferences and seminars at university and college levels. Dr. Urvashi is a very active in the area of human resource management, organizational and corporate governance. And she has several articles, research papers in international and national journals of her credit. And she has also been the editor of many journals of the College of GGS IP University. She is the lifetime member of Indian Journal of Commerce and Indian Accounting Association. We all welcome you, ma'am, in the session. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pathak ji, for a kind welcome. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
I once again welcome Director Sir, Govil Sir. They've just joined in. Now I would request my fellow host, Dr. Rachna Jain, to please steer the session forward.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Rachna Jain from Maharaja Agrasen Institute of Management Studies. After the introduction, now we are starting with the presentation of 10 selected papers. Selected papers will be presented by the authors themselves, and rest of the papers will be presented by the host. I request all the presenters to kindly stick to 4-minute timings for your presentation. Now, I invite Dr. Ajay Bamba sir, who will discuss on the topic challenges and opportunities in the post-COVID-19 world. Over to you, sir.
Hey, audible, ma'am?
Yeah. Yes, Dr. Ajay.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Good afternoon, Dr. Nandkishore Gargi, founder chairman MEATS, Professor G.P. Govilji, and executive members of MEATS and MEAPS, Professor S.L. Guptaji, Dr. Urvashi Sharma, and organizing team of the MEAPS. I will be presenting my paper on challenges and opportunities in post-COVID-19 world in context of governments, its leaders, and governance. As we have seen in this pandemic, governments at national level, more accurately, their leaders and executive branches have taken the front seat in responding to the COVID-19 crisis. This was very much clear when India's Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, was heading the workforce and addressing the nation very frequently. While a global pandemic has been a looming risk for the decades, COVID-19 has come as a shock to the society, our health systems, economies, and the governments worldwide. Leaders are under severe pressure to make decisions on managing the immediate impact of the pandemic and its consequences, and the decisions that will shape the state of the world for the years to come. Global problems are best solved with the global leadership, which has been lacking during this COVID-19. Unlike the 2008 financial crisis, when the US chaired the G20 summit and coordinated a global response, in this crisis, domestic challenges took priority over the international leadership. Even Europe, the second epicenter of the crisis, has not championed a coordinated international response, and other countries have been reluctant to follow China's lead. What can be the silver linings in this crisis, and how leaders use this moment to build a more prosperous, equitable, and sustainable world? The Chinese language expresses the word crisis at VZ, denoting a state of both danger and opportunity. Now we have to see also the opportunities looking into this. Leaders have to look beyond the current crisis to the potential challenges and opportunities in this era. From the global perspective, we have seen in last 5 months from the after COVID-19, the world is more divided, conflictual and nationalistic. But an alternative scenario is also within reach. In this scenario, collective action within communities and where necessary internationally will make a more rapid and peaceful exit from the crisis. Many governments are experiencing a rise in approval and trust, but given the existing huge trust deficit, there is no guarantee this is going to last. Politics could turn toxic as governments struggle to speedily control the pandemic or to communicate clearly about what they are doing and why they are doing. In India, we have seen this in the case of tussle between central government and few state governments also. The crisis has exposed how many people, even in some of the world's richest countries, live without reserves of cash or food and face difficulties in accessing the government assistance. To control bad situation due to COVID-19, governments have to increase their spending on health, social security, and other measures. Due to this, governments are facing gigantic debts. Some countries will be able to raise funding through the capital markets. Others will be facing the high interest rates for borrowings. In short, a financial crisis is in the offing, and without international cooperation, the world is looking at economic recession for all. Building on the jingoistic nationalism, there is a risk that some leaders will seek to focus the anger and frustration of their citizens on another country. Already we have seen the political leaders blame other countries for their own failings, including for problems before the crisis. But the better scenario can be if we have already managed these kind of extreme conditions before. Leaders during the Second World War in 1940s reflected on their failure to cooperate after the First World War. They started planning during the war only. They knew that cooperation would be essential to rebuild afterwards and to develop a global economy within which each country could grow. So taking a cue from the history, global leaders must begin to plan post-pandemic cooperation. The three tasks that confronted those leaders have their parallels today. First and most immediate is to fight the common enemy together. Nowadays, it's the virus. The second is political and geopolitical. Churchill, Roosevelt, and Stalin had to fashion a world that could accommodate their own diverse political regimes. The third task is economic. Economic reconstruction had to deal with the massive government debts and a broken global trading and investment system. Fighting the virus together require cooperation on the three things: research and knowledge. That means working together to understand and beat the virus. Maintaining the global supplies of the necessary materials and warning of the future outbreaks. For cooperation to work, countries need to agree common rules and empower an institution to oversee this. The World Health Organization exists to do this, but it is overstretched and underfunded. It needs to be properly funded to do this job. It also needs governments to hear and follow its advice. Some major countries ignored the warnings and the advice. So the WHO must be supported, financed, and empowered to do everything possible to point the world towards a circle of mutual trust. Politicians in any system can be tempted to take popular decisions rather than necessary ones. National leaders in US and Brazil were slow to take the pandemic seriously, but governors at the state level stepped up to take the decisions. All governments could do better by balancing the autonomy and agility at the local level with national level coordination. Global leadership requires a commitment to the transparency, especially when dealing with the infectious disease. And the last one, the economic reconstruction. After the Second World War, war-torn countries were desperate to get their economies restarted. Debts had to be written off. New flows of the investment had to be found. The result was a massive reset, delivering the mass housing, health, employment, and education. This may not be possible in 2020, but some changes occurring during the crisis could be built upon. As the pandemic does not discriminate demographically or geographically, it is crucial for leaders to focus on the common goals that are shared across nations. Although self-defensive measures may be provisionally necessary to safeguard the urgent needs of their citizens, countries that choose to share their competencies in the face of a global threat will have the advantage of enhancing trust and future collaboration across the borders. Concluding the paper, nonetheless, just as a crisis carries risk, it is also accompanied by opportunities. when the storm passes and the dust settles, whether the new world will emerge stronger and the post-COVID-19 normal more resilient and sustainable will rely on our ability to effectively mitigate the risk while harnessing the opportunities that these effects may present. As an old saying, heroes are the products of their time. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your valuable insights and knowledgeable inputs in the pandemic situation. Your inputs regarding opportunities, challenges, and telling us the strategies for handling the current situation is remarkable. Now I invite Dr. Manju Gupta for presenting her paper on the topic impact of COVID-19 on insurance sectors in India. Over to you, ma'am.
Very good afternoon to all of you. I am very thankful to the organizing team for adding my paper for the presentation. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible, but there's slight echo. Now it is fine. You may proceed, please.
Okay. The topic of my paper is impact of COVID-19 on insurance sector in India. The paper is jointly contributed by me and Dr. Sharda Garg. Dr. Sharda Garg is the associate professor in Mata Sundari College for Women, Delhi University. The unprecedented pandemic of COVID-19 has put the world trade and growth in great difficulty. It is now a global crisis of great magnitude and may be compared to Great Depression of 1929. The COVID-19 is a worldwide pandemic which creates an atmosphere of uncertainty among global economies. Could you please share the first slide, ma'am? As per IMF report, for the first time since the Great Depression, both advanced economies and emerging market and developing economies are in recession. For the year, growth in advanced economies is projected at negative 6.1%. Emerging market and developing economies with normal growth level well above advanced economies are also projected to have negative growth at rates of minus 1% in 2020. The pandemic has put tremendous pressure on government and economy at national and international level. The insurance industry of any country seeks to protect a country's people, assets, and businesses. Hence, the business of insurance has always been closely linked to a country's business performance and asset ownership. Life insurance protects the livelihoods of people and future earnings and has a direct correlation with earnings of people and their business performance and net worth. General insurance protects the asset and businesses and their valuation as well as overall economic activity. Hence, a popular way of measuring the insurance penetration is to benchmark it with the GDP of a country. The different credit rating agency and the World Bank have lowered the financial year 21 Indian growth rate at 1.22%, which is one of the lowest since 1990 economic reform. Almost all the sectors in the economy are badly affected by COVID-19, and the insurance sector is not the exception to it. It can be expected that insurer may be significantly negatively affected by the pandemic as they have to provide coverage for claim for death, health, and other adverse contingencies. But we can't say pandemic as a black swan event for well-run insurer. Black swan is an unpredictable or unforeseen event, typically one with extreme consequences, especially with respect to life and health insurance business. Lines as pandemics have always been most important mortality and morbidity exposure considerations. The world experiences these type of pandemics in order of 1 in 30 years since 1918 when H1N1 and then 1958 when H2N2 and thereafter illustrate that pandemics are more of the events well within the risk tolerance of insurers. If we talk about Indian insurance sector, it is basically divided into two categories, life insurance and non-life insurance. Both are governed by IRDA, that is Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority of India. If we are talking, can you please share, ma'am, second, third slide? Okay, if we are talking about the life insurance industry normally deals with pure risk, term policies, investment linked plans, and saving policies with guaranteed long-term returns. The total share of private players in the market in terms of collection of premium is 25.96% and LIC is 74.04% as per IRDA report. As you can see, first year of premium of both the private and LIC has significantly increased during COVID period. In case of any crisis, there is a rush to increase in term policies. But because of unstable cash positions and medical test cost, consumers are reluctant to take higher cover. The insurers are facing problem in marketing long-term saving policies as the interest rates are going down. And in case of investment-linked insurance, the consumer's confidence in stock market is badly hit due to several reasons. Consumers are interested to strong their liquidity position during the crisis. Third slide. Now, we are talking about the health insurance. India has traditionally been seen as an underinsured industry with private health insurance scheme covering only 18% of population in urban areas and a little over 14% in rural areas. Although the gap has been bridged somewhat by Ayushman Bharat, which has attempted to insure the poor also. As per IRDA report, in health insurance, there is a 10.91% growth in premium in April 2020 as compared to April 2019. Similarly, if we compare the May and June months of 2019 and 20, there is a growth rate in premium by 2.43% and 8.86% respectively. Apart from rise in demand of health insurance plans, there is also a demand in the health insurance plan with higher sum assured. People are now buying health insurance plans with a higher sum insured. Earlier, people think that 5 to 7 lakh sum insured. Health insurance plans are significantly large and enough to take care of all medical expenses. Now they have realized that this perception is wrong. Moreover, for the convenience of customer, IRDA has allowed the consumers to pay health insurance premium in easy monthly installment. Following this regulation, more and more people are now buying health insurance on monthly installments. In addition to it, in order to dismiss any general misconceptions about the applicability of health insurance to the cases of COVID-19, the IRDA has instructed insurers to accept COVID-19 related claims under active health insurance policies. Since the risk of COVID-19 is not currently priced under the active plans, these claims may cause an additional burden on the books of insurers if treated outside government hospitals. Currently, health insurance companies have adequate capital available to pay out claims arising from COVID-19. But if the pandemic continues for a prolonged period, it will fall under the severe natural disaster category, and it will be difficult for the health insurers with limited capital to manage these claims. Due to pandemic, the government has taken several actions towards reducing bond interest, repo interest, which will lead to challenges for the insurers also in terms of managing high reserves, liquidity risk, credit risk, etc. So in last, I want to say COVID-19 crisis has changed the way business operations are going to be conducted. The insurance sector required a complete switch to digital operation via robust IT platform accessible to all stakeholders, speedy claim settlement, new insurance products, etc. There is a famous line from literature: the current state of insurance industry can be described as the best of times and worst of times. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Manju Gupta, for such a wonderful presentation. Your paper gives a detailed insight about the insurance sector losses due to less revenue generation via premium in current pandemic situation. Now I would like to invite our next speaker, Ms. Sumedha Datta, for sharing her views on twists and turns in academic leadership during COVID-19. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon, Dr. Rachna. I request you to please allow me to share my screen.
Yes, ma'am, you can do that.
Ma'am, you are allowed.
Is the screen visible to all of you?
Yes, it is, ma'am.
Very good afternoon. I, along with my guide, Professor Pooja Khatri, have conceptualized a paper on twists and turns in academic leadership during COVID-19. One would never get exhausted with investigating and examining leadership. The construct of leadership has such numerous perspective and magnitudes that it always presents fresh ideas and inspiration. We are particularly going to focus upon academic leadership. No doubt, sufficient research exists wherein an extensive range of critical outcomes of academic leadership have been discussed in detail. However, the turbulent changes in the present time has created a demand to explicitly study the apparent changes and impact of academic leadership on the capacities of students in higher education. Unannounced developments in the field of academic leadership on one hand, and the great amount of stress being experienced by the college students during COVID-19 is what caught our attention. An effort has been made to conceptualize the studies related to academic leadership and COVID-19 so as to explore the interrelationship between them. With respect to research methodology, we have extracted the relevant research papers from Google Scholar, quality databases have been used, and we have ensured that the latest papers were included in our work. The specific objectives of our study are to study the relationship between academic leadership and its influence on institute, student, faculty, and staff, to identify exemplary leadership practices appropriate in the present COVID-19 situation. Undoubtedly, COVID-19 has affected the economy of each and every country. It has affected every sector of the economy also. However, its most damaging impact is on the academia. In academia, the authorities were forced to shut down their colleges, cancel the examinations, and they had to make a decision to shift towards remote learning. And now streaming of lectures on Google Meet, Zoom has become the new normal. Almost every nation swiftly planned academic leadership's workshops so that the faculty is acquainted with the latest tools of IT. To assist the institutes in turning towards remote teaching, academic leaders need to employ a new set of tools. And what are they? They are inspiration, idealized influence, and intellectual simulation. However, along with this new tool set, one also needs to provide them sufficient training, resources, and support. Not everyone has the potential to manage these changes aptly. The mediocre faculty were the non-tech-savvy ones. So in such a situation, it is the responsibility of academic leaders to leverage the skills and potentials of institute fraternity collectively. And for this, we recommend the following exemplary practices to be adopted by the academic leaders of the present time. The first and foremost, you need to establish ties with people. Now, these characteristics include integrity, trustworthiness, accountability, and in the present crisis, emotional stability. High IQ is what takes the cake. A leader who is high on EI would be able to identify the high level of stress being experienced by the faculty. This would make them more empathetic. And thus, it would help in building bonds of trust, which in turn will act as a catalyst of introducing transformative changes in the organizational system. Secondly, the academic leadership needs to incorporate distributed situational style, which promotes inclusivity, teamwork, and provides positive result in academia, where the faculty, the followers are intrinsically motivated, educated, and experienced. Collective efforts of the faculty can help in offering improved quality online courses. The third one, establishing clear channels of communication with all stakeholders. In crisis, frequent and clear communication of leaders with all stakeholders become all the more prominent. The content of the message is as much important as the medium or delivery selected. In the present time of crisis, if we see, the email is the most important source of communication when you have to communicate with faculty and staff. However, the millennial students of today, they may show an inclination towards receiving updates through an assortment of social media platforms. So thus, information is vital, and thus more than more channels of communication need to be adopted. With this, we come on to the conclusion. We agree that there is no such thing as complete academic leader. However, a leader equipped with adaptive capacity, flexibility, will be able to effectively deal with upcoming challenges with lesser inputs, and they may position themselves as an ideal allostatic leader. Allostatic leader is what is required in our academia right now. He is one who is able to bring stability in spite of all the hurdles or the hardships surrounding them. Our suggestion, a sincere commitment to these exemplary leadership practices will support academic leaders to arise from the crisis with an increased level of credibility and trust on their side. The future direction. Definitely, leadership as a topic has gained more attention in the testing times of COVID-19, when humanity is struggling to cope up with numerous unfamiliar hardships. In our current study, the authors have discussed the changing role of leadership in academia and higher education in the face of digital revolution. The conceptual framework presented in this study is a first step towards its empirical validation. This triggers a focus on thought-provoking topic, which may be examined by the future scholars in the years to come. These are the references that we have used in the paper. Thank you. Thank you for giving me your time.
Thank you for providing such a valuable knowledge regarding leadership exemplary practices for successfully managing challenges during COVID-19 pandemic. Now I invite next speaker, Mr. P.C. Pratihari, who is presenting his opinion on the topic Distant Horizon. Sir, over to you.
Thanks, everybody, and especially the esteemed members of the faculty. It's very difficult to present a paper after Sumedha presented her paper just before me. And please show my presentation, but I'll keep on speaking. Are you showing my slides, PPT?
Yes, sir.
Basically, my friends, the moment COVID is there, and now whatever we are experiencing, everybody is talking in terms of economy, finance, and yes, we have met the worst disaster, and it is to be spoken about. But then when I thought in terms of coming to, there are various sectors, various segments of life that is affected by this. Though I retired as a superannuated as the registrar of the Postgraduate Institute of Medical Education and Research in Dr. RML Hospital. Subsequently, I am onto different works, and right now I'm a director in the Boxing Federation of India. So when you look at sports, nobody is talking about the finances in sports. Possibly people haven't looked at it. Globally, the annual value of sports is around $800 billion now. And in terms of Indian scenario, 4 years, 3-4 years back, it was $3.5 billion. Billion means 7,500 crores. Just multiply it by that. As on date, even for a very rudimentary example, the advertisement value in sports is approximately, is approximately 8,000 crores a year. Having said that, and let's see, I have given the figures over here, and in respect of the value of this Olympics, Tokyo 2020 Tokyo Olympics, when it was allotted, that time it was estimated to be 6.5 crores or what I have written here, 7.3 crores. Subsequently, as on date, after postponement of the Olympics, it is expected that the expenditure will be somewhere around $28 billion. Next. Now, having said that, the impact of COVID-19 on Olympics is such that in the history of Olympics since 1896 onwards, the Olympics were never postponed. And this is the year it is postponed. Olympics were cancelled in 1916 because of First World War, 1940 and 44 because of the Second World War. Despite problems in Munich in 1972. terrorist activities in Munich in 1972. The Olympic didn't stop. Olympic was not postponed. It was just closed for 2 days and then we started on. This disaster is such that it is to be postponed. Now, in the postponement, whatever financial figures will come out, you have umpteen number of finance people to explain those things. Next slide. Now, my point is, we are talking of this millions, billions and whatnot. But who has generated these millions and billions? It is because of the sports personnel throughout the world. Now, what has gone into their mind? See, the point is, it's not that I prepare for Olympics today and after 6 months, I'll be there. The real medalists, they prepare 10 years in advance. Olympics, you know for certain, it is allotted 8 years in advance. Everybody knows. If you take the into consideration the case of the best gymnast in the world ever, Nadia Comăneci, is a Romanian American gymnast who won the gold, Olympic gold in at the age of 13, was picked up by the country at the age of 3. So that sort of a dedication these people have got. Now in the paper, if you go through it in detail, I have written something. In 2016 Rio Olympics, there was a girl called Simone Biles of United States. At the age of 19, she got 4 gold medals and 1 bronze. And till now, she has got around 28 medals. And she is expecting, because these people who are sturdy performers, they want to make an all-time record. Now she was expecting 2020 to again grab some other medals, and she's the most brilliant prospect. The moment she got the news, she stood in disbelief. What has happened? Because these athletes, they get a peak at some particular point of time. Everybody has prepared that they will reach their peak in 2020. Now that they have got a jolt and it has gone to 21, they have to readjust. They have to readjust something which they have worked for the last 4, 5, 10 years. Now, let's see, for example, there is another case. There is a girl, Shaunte Lowe. She's an American high jumper. This 2020 would have been her 5th appearance in Olympics. Mind you, 5th appearance in Olympics, mind it. She appeared in 4, 8, 12, and 16. This would have been her 5th appearance. And last year, she was afflicted with breast cancer. She was operated, mastectomy was done, and she is under chemotherapy. Despite that, she has been selected for this Olympics. And as per age, this is her last chance also. And if she appears the Olympics, and winning and losing is a very different thing. This girl has already won medals also. Please look into my detailed paper. But then we would have got a case that here is a cancer survivor who has attended the 5th Olympics. Now come back home, Maricom. Maricom first attended the 2012 Olympics and got a bronze medal. 16, she didn't attend. This year, she is one of the India's most important medal prospects. Why 2012 Maricom is the highest medal taker in the world in world championships, men and women put together? And if she loses this Olympics, then she is overage, because there is an ultimate cap of 40 years of age for Olympics. Just try to imagine these women or the athletes, those who have struggled so hard, what sort of a mental jolt they would have got. More so, they are senior athletes. They understand how to adjust themselves. They can cope with the difficulties. What about the youngsters? Therefore, we need to find a solution. We need to find a solution as to how to cope with this situation. That could be the immediate solution comes out that you have to go for a counseling. But what sort of a counseling? Nowadays, because of the COVID, there is isolation. They are at home, not in the camps. Even my boxers were in at home. They have just come to the camps and we have put them under observation, and thereafter the physical training will start only now. But then, what sort of counseling can be done to them? At home, parents. Parents can do at the most counseling in respect of their health and regular routine, nothing beyond that. The children, they don't listen much to the parents in these aspects. There can be a peer pressure. They can come and convince them. They can talk to them. They can convince them, okay, things are going well. Rest of the people are also similarly placed. Nothing to worry about it. The most important person to coach is the coach. I'm coming to the psychiatrist or psychological counselor separately, because everybody understands the moment counselor comes, they understand that, yes, he has come to counsel. That means there is something wrong in us. Therefore, in this aspect, it is the coach who has to tell them. The most important thing for counseling here is that the athletes have gone into a cell. They have to be brought out of that cell. So somebody has to talk it out to them. Unless and until they speak out, you just can't understand what is going on in their mind. And then if they speak out, you can address the problems. And at some point of time, you see, if they're in isolation, they are, of course, open to media, open to internet. Nowadays, if you switch on the TV channels, our journalists, they read out the news. 39 people have been killed as if something wrong has happened. Heaven has fallen on the earth. So we need to sensitize. You go through CNN, you go through BBC, things are different. You go through our channels, things are different. And you see what has happened. They need to be selectively ignorant. They have to be told to be selectively ignorant. That means this person is not to be accepted. And then the modalities of counseling, my friends. This athletes had a dream. Similarly, if you talk of, I'll take a minute more. See, Boxing Federation of India is a nascent federation which was formed in 2016. Prior to that, there was nothing. In the past, we got only one bronze medal each in two Olympics, 2008 and 2012. Thereafter, nothing. Now, 12 of our athletes are in the top 20 list of the world, top 10 list of the world. And a country can send a contingent of 13, nine boys and girls have qualified. I'm going for another qualifier. So I'm also keeping my fingers crossed. Therefore, what I mean to say, with persistent and strategical working out with our this athletes, the dream of theirs, lifetime's dream of theirs, that became a distant horizon because of the postponement, becomes a near reality, at least now. Let's keep our fingers crossed. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wisdom and knowledgeable inputs. I hope now everybody is going to understand the new vision that sport person are not only suffering financially and physically, but also psychologically too. I invite now our next presenter, Dr. Sangeeta Tripathi, who will speak on the topic, mental stigma due to communication crisis in the age of COVID-19. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Richa.
Thank you.
Because the time is a limit here, so I would like to start my presentation with the problem statement and methods and finding. I'm very happy to be the part of this conference. Dr. Rajay Bamba has already discussed about so many things about the impact of COVID-19 on country economy. So I will not go into that deep. I will just tell that everybody is talking about the COVID-19 impact on common people health and economy, afield. So my concern is here, why we have chosen this topic. We have chosen this topic. I would like to share my slides. Can I?
Yes, ma'am, you can.
Okay, just wait. In this one. Are you able to see it?
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
Are you able to see it?
Yes, ma'am, it is
okay.
Visible.
Yeah, okay. So, everybody is talking about COVID-19 and its impact on common people health and economy are failed. But how this phenomenon has affected mental health of common people in each country. Due to COVID-19, people are forced to live in home alone. So this is the isolation and lack of face-to-face communications. Phone messages and social media has become primary platform of information consumptions, which also caused to spread fake news or rumors among the people during coronavirus. While mainstream media, we have explored that it is overcrowded with the content of COVID-19, and they started to centralize the messages, informations, and they are doing it all on the cost of accuracy. So they turn intimidators that a new broadcaster to the public. So to contain the spread of coronavirus, lockdown was imposed in both the countries I'm talking about, Oman and India. It has become the great challenge to large sections of the society, especially a small scale business, daily wage workers and marginalized people who work to earn money on everyday basis. So coronavirus pandemic and long lockdown brought social pressures on the financial side. So here, people gripped in the fear of highly infectious disease, COVID-19, uncertainty of jobs, unemployment, and financial insecurity as the cutting salaries, loan repayments, increase of domestic violence. All these factors may lead to psychological mental illness, such as chronic stress, anxieties, depressions among the people of India and Oman. At present situations, country are giving priorities to the physical health and physical health, but nobody talking about the mental health. It means the mental health is totally ignored. Now I'm talking about my rationale of the study. In India and Oman, news related to COVID has been causing additional health issues, stress, as I told you. So our focus is to identify the cause and the mental stigma among Indians and Omanis to explore the impact of COVID-19 on people's behavior and practices of combating the situations by Indian and Omanis. To understand the reasons of communications crisis despite availability of hundreds of media platforms are available. So what are the significance? This study brings attention toward loopholes of reporting and presentation of pandemic news done by Indian media and other media. It also urges in need of additional worldwide strategies to combat mental health issues among people across the world, which is neglected at current. What are the method we have opted? So the method is here. We have primarily chosen a survey under quantitative method, and additional to analyze the data, we have used qualitative techniques like interview and schedules. The schedule and interview have been done to those survivors and psychiatrists and certain class of the people who are not able to fill questionnaires on Google Form. Quantitative data include 20 questions along with the demographic details. The questionnaire have been formulated in English language, and the data collection had been done from Dhofar, Salala, Oman, and New Delhi, India. One of my friends, Dr. Vinita Gupta, she is also a partner in writing this news, this paper. So for calculation of the Google form, we have circulation of the Google forms. We have used WhatsApp platform, and the area of samples I have already discussed about it. And variables of the study, I can say that gender, age, jobs, financial status are considered as independent variable, while emotions due to increasing COVID-19 graphs, media news and contents use social media, income security, overflow of media contents are some dependent variables. So I will not take you much time. I will just talk about the findings. The findings of this study display the complete scenario of mental health of Indians and Omani during coronavirus pandemic and lockdown period. The study shows clearly that Indian and Omanis both have experienced the same kind of pressures, anxiety, depressions, loneliness, and fear due to uncertainty of the life, job insecurity, and financial security. Social distancing and quarantine period have also affected all age groups and occupations. In the absence of face-to-face communications, Indian and Omanis feel distress and loneliness. During lockdown period, Indian and Omanis used social media as a primary tools for information and getting in touch with their friends and relatives. Some of them used mainstream media, while more than one quarter survived watching TV for news. Overflow of content on media shows COVID patients struggling in quarantine centers, hospitals, ups and downs of human life, misinterpretations of fact upsets them badly. So both of the platforms of communication are full of COVID-19 contents, which has become also a reason for mental stigma for the people of both the countries. People lose their trust on mainstream media. That's why they least bother about checking content reality on social media. Dread of the treatment and quarantine process, vulnerability of life, tree, losing their loved one life, social discriminations during and after treatment, and the financial crisis are some of the reasons for mental stigma in Omanis and Indian we found. And coronavirus has changed the lifestyle of Indians and Omanis both, as it changed all over the world. So because we are talking about these two countries, so a main focus is here. Now they are talking more about sanitation, cleanliness, mask, and new gloves are new normal to everyone. They are not using anything straight away brought from the market. So they bought stuff and washed them all before use. If it is not washable, they keep them for 4 to 5 days and then they are using. So these are some conclusions and recommendations. You can consider it both. So our conclusion can be considered as a recommendation to overcome from stigma. A positive outlook is needed. We need to spread the awareness about scientific facts associated with contagious of COVID-19. Better to stick in a routine, which include yoga, pranayama, and exercises. We need to understand that there is no way out except accepting the situation in a positive way. A flexibility, adjustability, and improvisations are the key elements to overcome our mental stigma. Our food and sleep play a prominent role in handling any adverse situations. Media is like a buffet, so we need to choose it wisely. We cannot see anything, just whatever is coming, so that we can get panicked. So and this is all about my paper, and these are my you can see my references, and I hope you like my presentation.
Thank you for expressing your views. Thank you, Sangeeta.
Thank you so much,
Gupta ma'am, for expressing your view regarding behaviors and feelings of distress and loneliness in people, whether it is for Omanis or for Indians, due to lack to face-to-face karwal, ma'am, to invite our next presenter. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon, everybody, once again. Our next presenter is Dr. Ruchika Singh Malyan, who will talk about the psychological impact of COVID-19 pandemic on college students in Delhi using generalized anxiety disorder scale. Over to you, ma'am.
A very good afternoon to respected chairpersons, faculties, and my dear colleagues. Do I have permission to share my screen, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am, you have. Please go ahead.
Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay. Okay, so me along with Dr. Lokesh Jindal, we together have worked on understanding the psychological impact of COVID-19 pandemic on college students in Delhi using generalized anxiety disorder scale. Just give me a moment, please.
Sure, ma'am, sure.
So as we all have been discussing since morning, how COVID has had a disastrous impact on mental status of people. I am facing few technical glitches. 2 minutes, please. I'm very sorry to interrupt the presentation in between.
Technical glitches are a part of life now.
I am really sorry for this. I'm trying to reshare because I'm not able to go back to my previous slide.
Do you want us to run your PPT?
I think I'm good to go.
Rachna, ma'am?
Yes, yeah. Ma'am.
I think I'm good to go.
Okay.
Yeah, so we have been discussing since morning that COVID-19 has been having a tremendous effect on the physical health of people as well as the mental health of people. The numbers are increasing day by day. The effect that we have been seeing in personal lives also is that when a patient is asymptomatic or is having a virus, then the person is asked to isolate and go into quarantine. Now, when a person goes into quarantine, what happens is that this isolation creates more depression and anxiety into that person. So far, when we did literature review, we found that all the researches that were done in the past were only based on clinical research, and no research so far was done to study the mental health of college students, specifically in Delhi. In this study, we have used a standardized 7-item generalized anxiety disorder scale to study the level of anxiety among college students in Delhi.
Ma'am, can I do that?
Yeah, if you can please play my presentation because I'm having few problems playing from here.
Rachna, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. I am doing just give me a minute.
Yeah. You may please share your screen now.
Is it visible?
Ma'am, this is the old presentation. The new one I had sent today in the morning.
You have sent in the morning? Okay. Actually, I have this presentation only.
Okay, never mind. I'll share my screen again. You can stop sharing your screen. I'll share the screen again. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it is visible, ma'am.
Okay. So the objectives of my study are to evaluate the mental status of college students in Delhi. Number two, to provide possible areas for psychological interventions with students. And third, to provide a basis for proclamation of government policies. The research methodology that we have opted is that we have done a primary research survey. It is a cross-sectional study consisting of population of graduate and postgraduate students of colleges students in Delhi. Rating instrument is, as I said, it's a structured questionnaire. We collected responses from 1,496 students through online and telephonic interviews. We collected responses related to their demographics and COVID-19 related stresses, like if they are feeling any anxiety related to impact on economy, delay in academic procedures, because we have been seeing the academic procedure is delayed these days, and are they receiving any social support from their family and friends. So this scale that we have used was the 7-item generalized disorder scale on a 4-point Likert scale. The items are there mentioned below that were there in the scale. For data analysis, we have done multiple kinds of analysis. First was univariate analysis using cross tabs, chi-square test was used to investigate significant relationship between sample characteristics and anxiety. Descriptive statistic analysis was conducted to demonstrate demographic and other characteristics of the respondents. Ordinal logistic regression analysis was done to screen significant variables. Then estimates of strength of association between variables was demonstrated by the odds ratio with 95% confidence interval. And finally, we did correlation analysis to evaluate the association between COVID-19 related stressors and the level of anxiety. These were the results of our study. Surprisingly, it came out that only 25% of students had no symptoms of anxiety, but the rest 75% of the population had some or the other level of anxiety, be it mild, moderate, or severe, which was very astonishing and disturbing to us to see this statistic. The univariate analysis was done. The relationship between demographic variables of students and the level of anxiety during the epidemic was seen. And moreover, it was seen that students who are from rural areas, students whose family does not have any steady income, and those who are living separately, which means they're not living with parents, or someone in their family is having COVID. These kind of students were having very high level of anxiety. The ordinal regression analysis of factors was conducted to show their association with anxiety during this pandemic. So in this model, odds ratio value was less than 0.05, which stated that at least one variable was statistically significant. And also in the test of parallel lines, we got values which indicated a good model fit with the observed values. And finally, the correlation between COVID-19 stressors and anxiety was conducted. So again, we found that there was not a positive relation between level of anxiety in college students with respect to economy. But yes, they were very much worried about academic delays. There was a positive correlation with influence in terms of epidemic on daily lifestyle. So there we found that there was a positive correlation. And we found negative correlation between social support from family and friends and anxiety. So to conclude my presentation, the reasons that we find has had an impact on anxiety is one, that people have been home quarantined and people have not been able to socialize, which has increased the level of depression and anxiety. Second, we have found that people living in rural areas have been having high level of anxiety. This can be understood because the economic, cultural, and educational resources between urban areas and rural areas is different. Sanitary conditions are different. Sensitization is different. The level of sensitization is also different. Although, as I said, there are certain favorable factors. If we would like to work on fighting against anxiety, we can ensure that the family has a steady income and ensure that the students are living with their parents, which give them a lot of security. So also we found that economic stressors and daily life, effect on daily life and academic delays, these were all COVID-related stressors. They all had positive impacts on anxiety. And these results are validated from previous studies that were already done. Like for example, Woodgate and all in 2020 itself has done a study which indicated that the risk factors associated with emotional and anxiety disorders in adults included the death of parents in childhood, not living with parents, and parents' psychological problems and mental illness. Similarly, others are also mentioned. So these studies are validating our results of the study so far. My recommendations, or our recommendations, I would say, are two-tier. One, what the educational institutes can do, and second, what the government can do. We educational institutes and academicians have to have a sense of control, provide a sense of control to students, provide a stable educational structure for students by drafting a policy of maximum schedule stabilization during lockdown. Because at their homes also, their schedule is so haphazard. If the academics is also not planned properly, that is going to increase the anxiety levels. And second is to intervene into their psychological space, which will help them survive this pandemic by taking steps like you can stay in touch, constant touch with students, listen to them, give them open ears, be a constant companion to them. That is what we teachers can do for our students. And secondly, the government can draft policies to work towards social inclusion of every student from all socioeconomic backgrounds. Develop an online learning ecosystem, which already the government is working on, but we can enhance this step. allow foreign universities or institutions to operate joint degree programs with Indian institutions so that students are able to get a global perspective. Because right now, it does not matter if the student is sitting in India and taking classes from a foreign university. We are all borderless today. Restructuring or merging different higher education regulators like UGC, AICT to ensure effective coordination. And I think that it is the educational institutions and the government, we both have to work hand in hand, and only then we can fight this problem of anxiety in students today. Thank you for your sparing your valuable time. These are my references.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ruchika. And I think technical glitches are all okay. That's a new learning these days.
Thank you so much. No and problem. I'm really apologize for all the technical glitches.
No. That's all right.
I hope my presentation will be well appreciated with the chair.
It is very well appreciated, ma'am. Now I would like to invite our next speaker, Dr. Malini Sharma, who will be presenting a topic, importance of behavioral economics and nudge theory in the light of COVID-19. Over to you, Dr. Malini.
Good afternoon, everyone. Just give me a moment to share my screen and start the presentation. Some technical problem, I guess, again.
Your presentation is visible now.
Yes,
good to go.
Yes, good afternoon again. The topic of my research paper is importance of behavioral economics and nudge theory in the light of COVID-19. I am looking at the COVID-19 from a very different perspective. But before I go on, what is behavioral economics? It is a field of study that incorporates insights from other disciplines in social sciences, such as psychology, anthropology, and so on. The key insight of behavioral economics is to think of human decision-making as a process. This is contrasted with the usual characterization in neoclassical mainstream economics as the end point of that process. For example, the agents are given certain end rules and people behave as if they are following end rules. This is how decision-making is in standard mainstream economics. That is, business choose at a point where marginal benefit is equal to marginal cost. However, individuals in reality do not behave with bounded rationality. Hence, thus the concept of behavioral economics.
ये बंद कर दो ये
तो ये बात बताओ जैसे
I would skip the review of literature.
क्या लिखा है?
Yeah, I would skip too many details on review of literature, but I have primarily used Kahneman and Tversky's and Richard Heller and Cass Sandstein's work in this research paper. Now, Kahneman and Tversky basically says that every individual has two cognitive systems, the automatic system, which is uncontrolled, effortless, fast, skilled, and unconscious, and the reflective system, which is controlled, effortful, slow, self-aware, and rule-following. Now, in every individual, very often the former takes over, and sometimes the latter. The thinking based on the automatic system is what leads to a very popular concept in behavioral economics, which is known as heuristics. Heuristics are basically mental processes which are akin to rules of thumb, and basically heuristics lead to certain biases at sometimes. And I will be discussing four basic heuristics, and I have tried to relate it to the context of behavioral economics. The first one is anchoring. Anchoring is the tendency to rely heavily on one prior recommended piece of information while making a decision. The purpose of these suggestions is to induce one to anchor one's final decision. For example, the governments today, you know, in the context of the tests that have to be conducted, where are they anchoring their information on? So in the light of the COVID-19 pandemic, several state governments and policymakers around the world are anchoring themselves to the actual numeric value of the number of tests done in other countries, say South Korea, followed by an adjustment or recalculation of these numbers to suit their own local population densities in order to optimize the number of tests. The second heuristic which becomes important in this context is availability. It entails assessing the likelihood of risks by asking how readily examples come to mind. Human beings process these risks in their brains through stories. For example, the story about of a person suffering from coronavirus in one's immediate neighborhood, say the next building, looms largely in one's head rather than the story about how many corona victims are there in, say, New York. And this makes one more fearful and prompts one decision to stay home during lockdown. Optimism and overconfidence, usually known as the above average effect, these are unrealistically, or people sometimes become unrealistically optimistic and overconfident about their abilities. We had seen the example of this optimism and overconfidence bias in during the initial days of the pandemic. Many governments across the world demonstrated this heuristic and did not impose serious lockdowns, primarily US, Sweden, and so on. Framing is the tendency to rely on context in which a choice is described when making a decision. For example, the Indian government conveyed the information on mandatory lockdowns to the public in terms of losses, in the sense that if people do not confirm, losses could be in terms of their health and life. This is the frame of fear of loss. And this works because the government knows that people are loss averse. This is basically on the basis of the prospect theory by Kahneman and Tversky. And libertarian paternalism is yet another framework by which behavioral economics can uprive public policy. I will not go into details of this because this is used in the concept of nudge, which is my next slide. Now, nudges basically are tweaks or prompts that influence behavior of the people without actually mandating it. In that sense, they are libertarian paternalism because they are liberty preserving, and yet the state can influence the choice option of the people, so it becomes paternalistic as well. However, it should be noted that the nudges avoid direct command mandates and any kind of enforcement. Now, when do we need a judge? The nudge is basically fraught choices, harder choices, infrequent choices, low feedback, no experience. Again, further without further ado, I'll move to the next slide. Now, here I have a small little cartoon from famous Simpson, wherein everybody knows that Homer is the customer and the shopkeeper. Then now, shopkeeper knows that Homer is lazy and is fond of donuts. So the shopkeeper basically utilizes this information and devises a clever choice architecture and keeps donuts away far from sight of Homer, and rather healthy fresh fruit right on the counter to nudge the nudge Homer to pick up healthy fruits rather than.
Sorry to interrupt. We need to wind up in 30 seconds. I'm sorry.
Mine is too long. So I'll just quick, just give me 1 minute. Yeah, okay, so nudges in action. Yes, nudges in action basically is, you know, as shown by the UX designer interface in the next cartoon with Winnie the Pooh wearing masks and practicing social distancing. Here I have a slide on design of nudges as a tool of policy. I have examples from across the globe, the behavioral insights team in UK. In India, the nudge units are very nascent. The central nudge unit by Niti Aayog was started only initially, and they have to be developed further. Now, I have a lot of examples of the use of nudge as preventive strategies against COVID-19 from across the world, from UK, from US, from various other places. In India, the first application of nudge was that the governments basically started television serials based on religious tests such as Ramayana, which could be shown in the national channels to nudge the elderly people to stay at home. This was the role of nudges in healthcare, the need of the hour, how do we, steps of deploying nudge in healthcare sector. And finally, my conclusion and policy recommendations. Let me just read out this, please. Government agencies can look towards an untapped resource, behavioral insights and nudges. If implemented effectively, nudges can yield better results using fewer resources than traditional approaches. The beauty of nudges nudging lies in its simplicity. Starting small can set a government agency on a journey to uncovering big results. In the current circumstances, as there is an exponential rise in the confirmed COVID-19 cases, nudges can certainly complement other stronger policy interventions. We must understand that every stakeholder's choice is an externality for us. In view of this, behavioral insights and nudges should be incorporated in public policy making, especially in these trying times. And I would like to end by a quote with Martin Luther King, given by Martin Luther King: the ultimate measure of man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands in times of challenge and controversy. So stay put, the storm will end in sunshine.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much, ma'am, for giving our audience an insight into such a valuable topic. Our next presenter is Ms. Shweta Bansal, who shall discuss about brands and their customers' connection during COVID-19. Over to you, Ms. Shweta. Are you there, ma'am? Ms. Shweta Bansal? Can you hear me? Ms. Shweta Bansal? All right, not wasting any time. Now I would like to invite our next speaker, Dr. Neeraj Mishra. Before wasting any further time, if Shweta ma'am is there around, then she may join us later on. Dr. Neeraj Mishra, who will present his topic, an investigation of factors influencing student selection of higher education institutes in Oman. I welcome you, sir. Please take
over. Thank you, ma'am. I will be sharing my screen. I will just take a minute.
Sure, sir.
Few seconds to share my screen.
Rachna ma'am, you may remove this one for the time being.
It's visible, ma'am?
As of now, I can see Shweta ma'am's presentation. Rachna ma'am, can you remove this presentation for the time being?
Ma'am, I had that. I think it is Shweta ma'am's slide. Shweta ma'am is sharing her screen right now.
Acha, but we couldn't hear her. Shweta ma'am, are you there?
Shweta ma'am's mic is off, I guess.
Shweta ma'am, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, I'm there.
Okay, yeah. We couldn't hear you actually. Dr. Neeraj?
Yeah, we will wait, ma'am.
All right, thank you very much, sir. Thanks a lot. Shweta ma'am, please carry forward.
Yes, ma'am. Can you visit? Is my screen visible?
We can see the screen. We can hear you. You just proceed.
Okay, ma'am. The COVID-19 outbreak has disrupted people's life as well as businesses. From having to practice social distancing and becoming accustomed to life without the outdoors, to continually sanitizing and washing our hands, wearing our mask, and seeing every other person, known or unknown, getting sick, the coronavirus is something none of us expected. This crisis has also changed the business landscape, and the unprecedented consequences are felt around the world. To endure this pandemic time, one of the greatest marketing strategy is to invest more in educating and connecting with customers. It will offer an extraordinary open door for organizations to interface with clients and fabricate sound relations with them. From logo updates to YouTube videos on hand washing, sanitizing, social distancing, etc., commercial brands and NGOs are declaring their social consciousness and promoting self-isolation and stay-at-home mode. For the last few months, we have seen a lot of creative posters and ads on various platforms related to COVID-19. The objectives of the study are to explore the advertising campaigns of various brands during lockdown, to know how the brands have connected with customers during the lockdown period, and to analyze what marketers can do to stay relevant in current time, that is in Corona time. Content analysis have been done of the three social networking sites, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, and various newspaper articles and blogs have been reviewed online to write this research paper. The first objective was to explore advertising campaigns during lockdown. This is the first advertisement given by a public health message given by Lifebuoy. It states that hand washing is very essential, be it with any soap. In fact, it's one of the advertisement, it also mentioned a portion of its rivals, which an individual can use to wash their hand. This was a commercial by Bata, in which they said, you wore them, you ran in them, attended meetings in them, and showed them off to your friends. You saw the word in them, but now it's time to give your shoes some rest for everyone's safety and a better tomorrow. Join the movement with Park Your Shoes and let's walk together. In fact, Bata also posted a video where it showed how people can share simple joys of life while being at home with family. This one is by Fevicol, which always uses a minimalistic approach. The ad uses the wordplay between Corona and Corona, which works, and the unusual space between the elephants additionally conveys the message. The Hindu, one of India's leading newspaper, sent its reader a simple and clear message to forestall the spread of coronavirus. This is the logo of Chiquita, the Swiss banana producer and distributor, which changed its logo during lockdown. And Miss Chiquita says, I'm already home. Please do the same and protect yourself. Nagpur City Police has always been active on Twitter with their informative posts and quirky responses. These are the three different ads given by them. Ixigo, the travel-based commercial website, also posted this, fake it till you make it and fake my trip. Nike said that if you ever want to play for India, then it is the time when you can play. It gives a strong message without restricting itself to product placement or visual metaphors. Grofers, when the lockdown was extended, Grofers said that people should not worry. They will be providing their services in lockdown too. Amul, these are the two commercials of Amul, which said better saaf than sorry, and Salamul Namaste, that they stressed on the point that Indian greeting has become global due to the coronavirus. These were some of the advertising campaigns run by various brands during lockdown. The second objective was how the brands are connecting with consumers. So these are the four brand activities which were brands involved in: providing information, broadening consumer service, expanding customer support, and sustaining and soothing. When these brand activities were mapped with Maslow's need hierarchy theory, the six levels of brand activities were found. Level one was about providing information and progressing in the direction of creating awareness on significant issues about the pandemic. Lifebuoy, Audi, these were the brands that were prevalent on this level of activity. Level two is about brands stretching out a helping hand to ease problems for the customers due to constraints imposed by the pandemic. Like Audible provided free audiobooks for the customers. Tata Motors extended AMCs. Unilever reduced its prices of hand wash and sanitizers. Also, there were various brands which included initiatives to go to extra mile in minimizing health risks to consumers, and they basically belong to food and beverage industry, like from McDonald's and Domino's. Level three involves informal messaging, but to ignite respect and recognition for those who are working for our safety and well-being. The campaign by PM Modi on 22nd March to applaud the efforts of Corona warriors is the main example here. Level four extends the brand engagement to near and extended community to serve a larger purpose, like providing water, shelter, food, provision for healthcare services, protection from infection. These were the major activities done. Mahindra Holidays offered government as...
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt. Could you please wind up in 30 seconds if possible, please?
Yeah, ma'am. Level five starts with the two-way communication, and level five involves sharing or creating virtual tours of museums. Like OU shared a post about work from home activities and asked people to do so. Level six is highest on emotional connect, but has least activity. Now, how to stay relevant in current times? These were the various ways through which brands stay relevant in current times, like great time to showcase leadership. N.S. Orson, the CEO of Marriott International, put a great example for it. A brand should not make it about themselves. They should be compassionate towards people. They should keep the human element as much as possible. Contribution and giving back, Tata Ki Chakra Gold contributed towards it. The existing content should be reused wherever possible, like Kia Motors did with its Rewind Kia campaign. Always in marketing is the mantra to constantly readjust and reassess their marketing. pandemic was the time where e-commerce was accelerated. Big Bazaar, Grofers, these were the major brands where e-commerce was basically accelerated. And work from home became the way digital place for many people. So at last, I'd like to conclude with COVID-19 has resulted in closing up of everything. There was a complete lockdown of around 3 months in India, which means apart from essentials, nothing was open. During this period, people were connected with each other digitally only. This digital connection was used not only to be in touch with family and friends, but businesses also went online. Businesses created a positive image of their brand during this period and helped in spreading positivity between the people. Various brand engagement activities also helped brands in creating connect with the customers. And what can be done to stay relevant, it was also stressed upon. So different brands have proven to create an impact on the consumers with their efforts during this pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Our next speaker is Dr. Neeraj Mishra. I am very thankful to sir for being very considerate. Over to you, without wasting any time.
I will be very brief, ma'am. I will just focus on my methodology and the
that findings. Would be wonderful. That would be wonderful, sir.
It's visible, ma'am?
Yes, sir. You may proceed, please.
Okay, this is a research which we have done on the factors influencing student selection of HEIs in Oman. A brief introduction. I can't move the slides. Okay. A brief introduction before I start with my methodology and the findings. We know that the COVID-19, it has affected every industry, and HEI is a sector which has been badly hit. In Oman, what we see is that there are more than 70,000 cases, active cases now, and the student admissions have suffered a lot. So what we thought that let us investigate during these times, what factors will influence the students in selecting the HEI. I'll just go to the research model. I'm just skipping the slides. We identified from the existing literature in area of HEI selection that there are three broad parameters to affect HEI selection. We have the fixed college characteristics. We have the college effort to communicate with students and the external influence which we have on students which affects HEI selection. The research methodology, the study was both exploratory and descriptive in nature. We had a sample size of 200 students, which consisted of students of first year and foundation. We have surveyed five HEIs in Oman in engineering and management discipline. We use stratified and the purposive sampling method just to have a balanced representation from Omani and expatriate students. And the strata which we have used was nationality, age, gender, etc. Now, quickly going through the results. Now, male and female, the percentage is indicated here. We had 64% male, 36% female. Majority of the respondents were in the age category of 18 to 23 years. Similarly, the students who were pursuing their graduate degree courses, they were the majority of the respondents. They were 56%. And Omani nationals were around 56% and non-Omani were 44%. Now, the scale which we used was again tested for reliability. We used the Klondike Alpha to test the reliability of the scale. And if you have a look, most of the scale items, you will have a Klondike Alpha of more than 0.8. Anything above 0.7 is acceptable. So the scale was thought to be reliable. Now, we have used a correlation method in SPSS to test the hypothesis. And it was found that there is a positive relationship between the fixed college characteristics and the college selection. The relationship was moderate. It's 0.75. It was found to be significant. Same case with relationship between the college selection and the college efforts to communicate with the students. So the communication aspect was also found to be significantly related with the college selection. And we found a weak positive relationship between extra influences, means influences which we have from our peers, from parents, from teachers. It was weak. It was 0.142. Now, in a conclusion, before I start the conclusion part, there is a small intervention I will be mentioning here. We are still working on the paper. We are analyzing the data through Smart PLS, and we'll be doing the model testing and the model validation, which we will be publishing subsequently. Now, the study has established that there is a positive relationship between the fixed college characteristics and the college selection. So what we suggest is that some of the factors of the college, like location, reputation, academic programs, library, sufficient number of classrooms, etc., they play a very important and decisive role in the college selection. The study has also concluded that there is a positive relationship between the college efforts to communicate with the student and the college selection. So it is advised that the college should engage in effective communication to attract students. And there is a positive but weak relationship between extra influences and the college selection. So this area, if need be, may be ignored by the policymakers and the HEI. Thanks.
Thank you very much, sir, for such a lucid and very well-timed presentation. That is actually need of the hour.
Yeah, actually, I went very fast because of the time limitation.
Thanks a lot for considering that, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Now I invite our next speaker, Dr. Shalu Agarwal, to present her paper, Coronavirus Pandemic, Halt to Travel and Tourism Sectors. Over to you, ma'am, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, may I share my...
Yes, ma'am, please, you can do that. Share your screen, please.
Is it visible, ma'am?
Yes, it is visible. Please proceed.
Good afternoon, all of you, all the dignitaries and the organizing team of MAMES. I would like to thank you for giving me this opportunity to share my views on coronavirus. My topic is coronavirus pandemic, halt to travel and tourism sectors. So first of all, coronavirus is one of the worst virus ever to hit the tourism industry. Actually, tourism industry an epidemic becomes the ultimate driver of natural tourism industry to the collapse, as it affects all human activities like social, religious, athletic, artistic, and even cultural. As the news of virus started picking up from November, the percentage of cancellations started going up aggressively. The value at risk will be multiples of tens of thousands of crores. Lots of people love to travel or have to travel for their development, for their entertainment, for their livelihood, for their education. But number of travelers are opting to stay home amid fear of exposure to the coronavirus, which has spread to almost all the countries since late December, infection people generally. Now, I would like to tell impact of coronavirus on tourism in India. Travel and tourism industry in India has become a significant contributor to the country's GDP. Not only GDP, the sector even generates a large employment base. So when by mid-March, the popular tourist attraction in India started closed down and the news on putting a halt on flying began to make rounds, we all started to predict grim future of the travel industry in the country. The Indian tourism and hospitality industry is expecting a potential job loss of around 38 million due to coronavirus pandemic. The outbreak of COVID-19 has brought effects on money aspect like flight cancellation, travel bans, restaurant closed, all indoor events restricted, emergency declared in many countries, falling business assurance, growing panic among the population, and uncertainty about the future. March, the closure of tourism sites and attraction, cancellation or postponement of major festival and events, and restriction on public gathering in many countries, the impact of COVID-19 on global tourism has been overwhelming and immediate. The coronavirus basically, aap ye keh sakte hain, the coronavirus hit the tourism industry very, very harshly and very poorly. So I would like to conclude the tourism sector, and we are hoping the tourism sector is strongly hoping for comeback in near future. But I request you all, please don't go outside, stay at home until and unless it is very important or necessary. Stay at home, save your lives and others too. Stay healthy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shalu. That was a very short and sweet presentation. Now I would like to invite our next speaker, Dr. Shalu Juneja, to please present a paper on effects of COVID-19 outbreak on volatility of BRIC stock market. Over to you, ma'am, please.
Yes, good afternoon to all of you, for team members and dignitaries also. So I start my paper with my PPT. So please, 1 minute. Yes, please tell me, ma'am.
Ma'am, it is visible. You may please proceed.
Okay. Yes. Yes, my topic is the effects of COVID-19 outbreak on volatility of BRIC stock market. So I start with the only introduction and then go to research methodology. And mainly BRIC countries, I have selected these because these are very dominating countries in emerging stock market in last recent decades. So I have taken Brazil, Russia, India, and China for this. And main indices of these are Bovespa, IMOX, Nifty, and SSE respectively. So what is the main objective of my study? That is mainly to be focused on the impact of COVID-19 on basically volatility of Indian stock market and three other international stock markets, that are BRIC. And main research methodology of this paper, I have taken the main closing prices of BRIC nations and time period for this. I have taken time series analysis I have taken applied, and 5 years data I have taken from the date of 1st July 2015 to 30th June 2020. And eViews 11 software that has been applied in this study, because this software is basically for time series analysis. And this figure explain Brazil, Russia, India, and China, and these are the main indices of it. Yes, data collection and tools. Mainly, I have collected data from secondary sources, that is yahoofinance.com, because this is time series and it always taken from secondary data. And main tools are applied, that are descriptive analysis and Granger causality test. You can see in this figure, this is the figure of descriptive statistics. In this, mean, median, and standard deviation, that is highest in Bovespa, means Brazil stock market. And if we talk about skewness, Kutchesis, and Jarkibera, that is highest in national stock exchange, that is from Indian stock market. So this is very interesting slide. If you see, this is the price series of Bovespa. In very starting in 2015, the closing prices of Bovespa, that's were very low. And day by day, year by year, that is increasing. But in 2020, that this date is 18th March 2020, on this date, you are looking that the rates, the closing prices are very low due to the reason of COVID-19. And same if we talk about Russian stock market, in very starting, this is increasing year by year, but on the date, this date is 21st March 2020, when this declined due to the reason of COVID-19. And same in National Stock Exchange in India, and this date was 23rd March of the 2020. On that date, the lowest price has been described. And if we talk about China's stock market, in which you can see that the prices are daily by daily or year by year up and down, you can see. And of COVID-19, there is no extra effect in the year of last 2019, you can say in November, or you can say January, February, and March. Even I have taken the time period from 30th June 2020, there is no effect of COVID-19 on China's stock market. This figure has been concluded by eView software. Data I have taken from Yahoo Finance, but this is concluded from EView software. Now I have applied log series that is returns of closing prices, same criteria. In very starting, the data was stationary, but on the date of March 2020, the up and down are very high in Bovespa stock market. Same in Russian stock market. In 2018, there was also some up down, but that was also still, that was same from 2018 to 2020, from February up to February 20. But after February, after 21st March, this was clearly visible that very fluctuating. And if we talk about National Stock Exchange, same thing in March 2020, that is very effective market by reason of COVID-19. But if we talk about China stock market, from the very starting 2015 to 2020, fluctuation is the same, volatility is the same. Now go to Granger causality test. That means that is determined whether one time series data is useful in forecasting another time series data. And these are the main results. I conclude with this results. I have taken the relationship of NSE with Bovespa, NSE with IMOX, NSE with China stock market. The highest effect of India that is creating by COVID-19 and Chinese stock market, because results are very clear, and highest rate is in China and India, that's our 0.83. So this is the main conclusion. China market is very affected market in the period of COVID-19 for India. So a lot of thanks to listening me, and these are my references, and a lot of thanks now to all the team members and dignitaries also. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shalu Juneja, for such a wonderful presentation. After this last presentation, due to the paucity of time, it was not possible for us to present all the selected papers, but we have this in a document together to acknowledge the contribution of other presenters, which are deemed to be presented in this international conference. Dr. Rachna?
Yes, ma'am. So due to paucity of time, we couldn't able to present all the papers. So right now we are showing the slide so that it is treated as deemed to be presented. Here, have a look. These are the papers. These are actually more than 200 papers, and the authors are more than 350 over here. So we have just showing the PPT pliers. Slide so that it is treated as deemed to be presented in the presentation on in the conference only.
We thank all the presenters, all the participants, everybody who contributed to making this international conference a great success. It would not have been possible without so many people contributing to the conference for the papers, as presenters, as guests. Thank you very much, everybody, for being with us. So these are the number of papers that we have received for the international conference. So all of you now looking at the list, you can understand that it was not practically possible for us to conduct all the presentations on this online platform. Thank you, Dr. Rachna. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
We are fortunate that we have such a senior academician amongst us, Professor Dr. D.R. Agarwal, who has more than 55 years of experience in academics. He's currently working as Professor Emeritus at Starix University, Gurugram. Sir, I welcome you. I request you to please bless us with your words. Sir, you need to unmute your mic.
No, I'm audible.
Yes, sir, audible. Thank you.
Yeah. So now I start with my favorite poet, डॉक्टर नीरज, दिन निकला तो पुकारों ने परेशान किया, रात आई तो सितारों ने परेशान किया। गर्ज ये है कि परेशानी कभी कम ना हुई, कभी हमारे हालात ने कभी कोरोना ने परेशान किया। रेस्पेक्टेड चेयरमैन, गवर्निंग बॉडी, ऑर्गेनाइजर्स, डायरेक्टर सर, माय एस्टीम्ड फ्रेंड्स, कोलीग्स एंड डॉक्टर संजय मंगला, हु हैज बीन वेरी क्लोज टू मी, एंड आई एम वेरी हैप्पी दैट सच ए फाइन इंटरनेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस इज बीइंग ऑर्गेनाइज्ड दैट टू ऑनलाइन, where 220 research papers you got, you really deserve all appreciation. My thanks and my congratulations. Madam, in fact, I am very grateful to the organizers for giving me an opportunity to interact with the fine set of intellectuals, and really, I'm so happy. One thing I tell you, you were talking of 55 years. Today, incidentally, I have completed 59 years of my teaching career without any break of single day in my career. I started on 26th July, and now it is 25th July, 2020. 61, 20, 59 years. So I have completed. Now, in fact, higher education institutions are supposed to provide not only quality higher education, but also a research output which should be socially relevant, socially useful, and which should be for the welfare of the mankind. But you also know that coronavirus is also the research output which has come from laboratories. I would not name anything, but this research output, whether it is for the human well-being or not, this you can say. Coronavirus, what is had done? You just imagine one figure that I'm talking of. From 16th July to 22nd July, we had 270 lakh corona cases, eclipsing Brazil, which had 260 corona cases, and 500,000 cases were there in US. This is the situation which now ultimately we are hoping for the best. Our scientists, our researchers are very well working towards finding out the vaccine. Experimentation, trials, and the phases are going on. Let us hope for the best. Results are yet to come. I remember Dr. Marshall, my favorite economist, when he said political economy or economics is the study of mankind in the ordinary business of life. It examines that part of individual and social action which is most closely connected with the attainment of material requisites of well-being and their use. Thus, it is on one side a study of wealth, and on the other, and more important, the side, a study of man. It means human being is a social man. He is a social animal. When there are so many activities apart from economic activity, economic activities are the routine activities for the livelihood. You cannot remain, your life cannot remain without life. My point is very clear, but now cultural activities, literary activities, other social activities, morals, or so many activities, they are missing. This is the direct effect of, just you imagine, when there is marriage ceremony, only the family members are, as a part of condition, they can attend the marriage ceremony. So far as funeral, chautha, uthala, these ceremonies are concerned, only the immediate family members can attend these functions. So we have narrowed down our all social activities. You can just imagine one example I'm giving. I have been a student of physics. There are so many laws, Ohm's law, Charles' law, Biles' law. But there is in India, there is one law which is the greatest law, and it is the son-in-law. Nowadays, when son-in-law visits our family, he is also asked, sanitize your hands, wash your hands. He goes to the washroom. A new normal has been established. This is all the effect of coronavirus. Can you imagine such a situation? We never thought of this. Now I'm coming on the second part, which is very relevant, which is very important. S.K. Agarwal, retired IAS, was talking, because I have also noted down the figures, but I'm now not going to repeat. One thing I'm telling you, that our dreams for $5 trillion economy has been totally shattered. I was just working out that nowadays, our GDP is 206 lakh crore rupees. And if you just multiply by 75, then your GDP becomes in the year 2024-25, it becomes 375. When I applied the formula, Pn is equal to P01 plus R by 100 to the power n, n was 5. Immediately I got that the rate of growth should be now 13%.
Sir, your knowledge is so vast. Your knowledge is so vast, even a complete day would be less for us to learn. Once the college reopens, we would love to have you in our institution and learn from you.
I'm concluding. Just to say few words that this process now goes on. Now Keynes comes on the scene. He gave the policy of pump priming, compensatory spending. The government has also done the same. Last, I'm also highlighting that up till now, there was no concept of mental health. Mental health, this concept was only limited up to physical health. We were talking of whenever there was any problem, it was related to bhoot, paret, nishachar. Aur hamare yahan kabhi bhi is taraf dhyan hi nahi diya gaya ki mental health. WHO has worked out that there are a number of psychologists in India need, psychiatrists we need, there are number of counselors which we need, and as per WHO norm, just imagine we need 3 psychiatrists per 1 lakh, and we have got only 1. So I have to say that coronavirus has affected all aspects of our personality. Now, definitely, what we are doing, online teaching, online this, a part of personality development is somewhere missing in our country. Nowadays, we are just talking of online teaching, online in our online, somewhere the hands of teacher on the heads of his child, his son, or anyone, a student, they are missing. So a great thing is missing. With this, I thank you for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to speak with such a fine set of academicians, industries, administrators, and so on. I'm really highly grateful to you.
Thank you very much, sir.
I appreciate your efforts for organizing such a fine seminar and international conference. My congratulations. Thanks, ma'am.
Thank you very much, sir. Thanks a lot. Your words definitely have the rich experience flavor, I must say. And now I would like to invite our chair of the day for the technical session, Dr. S.L. Gupta. So please give some critical reviews about the papers. Presentations, please go ahead.
Yeah. Am I audible now, madam?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, audible, visible.
I'll just say 1 minute regarding introduction and then I'll go for the summarizing the papers. Respected Dr. Nandkishore Garakji, founder of the Maharaja Agarsen Technical Education Society, Professor Dr. Garg, Professor Dr. Ravi Kumar Gupta, Conference Chair and Director of Maharaja Agarsen Institute, Dr. Khurana, Conference Coordinator, Dr. Sanjay Mangla, Convener, Dr. Lokesh Sindhal, Co-Convener, Madam Dr. Silpi Agarwal, Dr. Rachna Jain, Dr. Pathakji, and other members of Organizing Committee. Good afternoon to everyone. I would like to again thanks to Organizing Committee to invite me as a technical session chair in this one-day international conference. And really, it is an international conference because people are participating from Oman and other countries. So it's not like the name international, but it's really international conference. I will speak like in my introduction, it was mentioned that my postdoctoral area is quality education. Now, everybody know all colleges, universities, schools, even schools are facing this quality education issue. As per various studies done by independent research agencies like KPMG, E&Y, Deloitte, PwC, and other QS ranking agencies. And in this agency's research, they say there are 4 or 5 old norms of education, like course design, course curriculum, one. Second is quality of faculty. Third is quality of students. Fourth is campus life. Fifth is technological facilities. Now new norms of education is there. First is personalized support to students and faculty. Second is flexible and structured approach to education. Third is innovative environment. Fourth is innovative mindset. Fifth is innovative like leaders of the online education. All these 5 parameters we have to benchmark with top institution in India as well as in the world. Now regarding this presentation, I like to say few points which are common for everyone. Well-organized presentations and well-organized this conference also. I congratulate this team. They have put very hard work to organize such wonderful, memorable conference. All papers created stimulating papers, mind-blowing papers, relevant theme was considered, selected by the presenters, knowledge-enhancing papers, and structured research papers. Now I'll talk one by one. First topic or paper was challenges and opportunity in the post-COVID-19. Although the presenter given a lot of new things, but few more things can be included. Being a research methodology student, I give my ideas, agree or not agree, that is up to the committee and the research scholar. He can include the impact in sectoral impact like trade economics, finance, banking, governance and regulation, also health issues, labor migration. None of the speaker talk about labor migration issues, which was one most important issue in the whole government sectors like Maharashtra and Delhi, Bihar, UP, everywhere. Technology and research issue were also there. Innovation was also there. So these additional things can be added in this research, further research. I just giving suggestions. He talk about good points regarding national government initiatives from Prime Minister addressing frequently, organizing meetings with the various sectors, PM with the CMs, and he talk about various good domestic challenges, national challenges, international challenges, and he also discuss about government fights between central government to state government. Trust war is there, lot of problems are there, political problems are also there, economic problems are there. So he presented very well, but one suggestion, he can use little bit research methodology part also and use the presentation PPT methods also, so more clear to the attendees and listeners. Otherwise, it's okay, good. Now, second paper was impact of COVID-19 on insurance sector. So this paper, which like my keys, more suggestions which can be included in this paper. The presenter never talk about what is the insurance market share, like what is the urban market share, that is presently 18%, rural market share is 14%, and in India is underinsured company, like in US is approximately 97%, like in GCC, Oman is 85%, and now government is going to mandatory for health insurance from maybe September. So little bit more things can be added in the paper. And the researcher highlighted good thing that is also in Oman also. IRDA instructed all the companies to take COVID care and include the active inclusion of this insurance coverage. That is
sir,
also good.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
We can't see you. Can you put your video on? We can't see you.
Yeah. Okay, fine. No problem. Now, okay?
Yes, I will see you in a while. Yes,
yeah, yeah.
So now we can see you.
Yeah. And the presenter talk about significant increase in claims. That is true. And the insurance companies are facing losses also. And they're collecting the less premium also. This is also highlighted by the presenter. And he talk about life insurance, general insurance, and he talk some other things. But I suggest in this type of presentation, we can have the latest benchmarking and comparative studies that give you more like significant for the researchers. And I am critically being I say like one thing, the player's job is always to win the race or get the goals, but the referee's judge's job is to file the fault findings. So I'm not fault finding, but just giving my observation as a research student, as a research scholar. Okay, regarding third paper, twists and turns in academic leading during the COVID-19 by Sumedha Tripathi and Pooja Khatri. And we every day talk about this academic leadership. So first, the scholar highlighted relationship between this new relationship and old relationship. We always talk with the students. Now we have initiated new relationship between student and teacher, teacher and management, management and other stakeholders. And this required a lot of caring and put efforts. Like in our college, we put 6-7 ways, like WhatsApp groups are there, SMS we are sending the student for each and everything, emails we are sending, on website we are putting, informal groups of the teachers and students. So different ways. So this is the one thing. And we redesign our teaching programs, like course design, lecture plans. And we can talk also pre-class training, post-class training, pre-class methods, various teaching methodology, pedagogies is there. Like hybrid teaching method is like using flipped classroom is there. So, the scholar can talk something about training open resources. Open resources, now everybody talk OERs, like SWAM is there by Government of India, SWAM, these channels are there, this EPG Parsala is there, NDL is there, so many, and for these resources, we can talk, and we can talk various digital platforms are there, non-digital platforms are there. So presentation was good, but still the researcher can, the sampling was not clear in this research paper, research design was also not clear. We can include this implication of studies also, how this study is good for present stakeholders. And otherwise, is a good paper. Yes, please.
Sir, I would request you to please, if we can do it in a little summarized way, because 4:30 we are supposed to start with our valedictory session as well. If it is
okay,
possible.
Okay, so fourth, yeah, please. No problem.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Fourth is Distant Horizon. It's a good paper. And Distant Horizon, which I understand, is a combination of social sciences, academic research, and game development and sports or gaming. So the author explained very well. But he can use some primary, he is focused on basically secondary data. little bit, he can have the primary data also, like interview method, focus group method, and some developing the skills, etc. Otherwise, it's a good paper based on the secondary data.
Well taken, Dr. Gupta.
Yeah. Mental stigma due to communication crisis in the age of COVID-19. This is also, again, a good paper. And as per many studies, including WHO, now they say minimize watching, reading, and listening news of COVID-19. When in the beginning, we also be very shocked when we got the news about US corona and German corona or UK news and other things. So that is also can be included in the study. Otherwise, this paper is good. The presenter spoke about social media and how the social media is affecting us and how the government is fighting. And the paper be considered as a Dhofar study, means Oman study. I am also in Muscat. So it was good. And she explained qualitative and quantitative, both type of data are used in the research. So it is a good paper. Now, 6, psychological impact of COVID-19 on college student in Delhi. This is also a good paper. And these 3 words, depression, anxiety, and stress. I don't know what is the level, but people say, and researchers say, level is increasing. So the presenter can may correlate with these 3 depression level or these 3 mental or psychological impact with the health and medicine, social significance, and economic sector also. Otherwise, it's good. Next, 7th. Importance of behavioral economics and nudge theory in light of this paper was of COVID-19. So this nudging theory is coming very fast. It was developed by Nobel winner Richard Thaler. And this talks like indirect way of positive things we have to communicate in indirect way, like organ donations, social norms. And she has cited a lot of examples of social norms also. So this nudge theory primarily helps in decision making and public policies. Now, 8th paper, brands and their customs connections during COVID-19. So this was well presented and cited a lot of examples of Bata, Lifebuoy, Fevicol, and Hindu. Many examples she cited, Nagpur city, so was well presented. And only one thing I like to add from my side, as per PwC research, 59% customer lost their human touch now after in this all overall studies, and 75% looking human relations or sorry their relations with human versus automated, means they're looking and technological. In US there is a study that 95% customers are only by interacting with only by the IT support, by like AI and all these things. Paper 9th, an investigation of factors influencing student selection of HEIG in Oman. While well presented, he Dr. Neeraj highlighted the hypothesis testing, and he concluded by various factors like location, reputation, employment, like that India we call placement, facilities. So these are the various factors. But now due to the COVID, the admissions are decreasing everywhere, not in Oman, India also, and other parts of the world also. So well presented paper. Now this next paper, 10 number, like this related to travel and tourism. So in this paper, the presenter talk about social, cultural, religious, various significant aspects, flight cancellation, uncertainty. But the presenter not talk about some issues which I say should talk about employment terminations. Like British Airways has terminated 36,000 employees. In US also, 4.6 million jobs likely to be terminated, and hospital industry, cruise industry, hotel industry, restaurant industry, all are badly affected by this travel and tourism. Now the last paper, on the effects of COVID-19 on this BRIC stock market and volatility. In these 2 major issues highlighted by the researcher presenter also, returns are flexible and prices are very, very highly flexible. A and she should can comparison, can give the one comparison chart also. And dark trading of the stocks, she has not talked, but maybe I did, I don't know. I am not a particularly, I don't deal much about the break and finances. And I say only one thing by which we learned by the corona. Good days give happiness. We enjoy very good days, all good days. Now bad days give experience. We are getting a lot of experience. In last 4-5 months, the online teaching, we tried about 80-90 tools. Even video, role plays, group discussion, simulations. So a lot of things we are learning by this bad experience. And best days give the memory. Like today is the best day for Maharaj Agarsen and for us also. So that give the memories. Now, a few more things, only 2 minutes I'll take, madam, with your permission. See, like India and globe, now earlier we used to talk geographical boundaries and market segmentation, but now no boundaries. 2 billion people are using the Facebook and is a Facebook nation. The world is called Facebook nation. And digital culture is developing. People like it. Even retailing and education and insurance and doctors are giving the appointment through online and checking the patient through online. Even Australia professor or UK professor taking class in Singapore or Singapore professor taking class in US, like Indian professor taking class in Dubai and Oman. So, and interaction methods are changing, like AI and this Internet of Things are coming very fast. And we now only find the possibilities in there is where there is impossibilities. So we have find possibilities for each and everything. And we accepted the change. There is a famous book, Who Moved My Cheese, written by Dr. Spencer Johnson. In that book, talk about change management. We adapt the change, monitor the change, ready to accept the change. So this is good thing for changes.
So post-COVID, we would like to have you in our institute to share your knowledge with us post-COVID-19, once all this settles down.
Yeah, definitely. So I wish Maharaj Agarsen Institute of Management keep flying their flag high. And the institute and the college or whatever you call have a great potential, and you encash that potential and opportunity during the COVID. Thank you very much. And I like, again, thanks to organizers to provided me wonderful opportunity on this occasion of international conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot, sir. Pleasure is all ours. Now I would like to invite Dr. Urvashi to please provide her valuable remarks.
Thank you, Shilpi. Am I audible to all?
Yes, ma'am, you are. Please go ahead.
Okay. So in short, as sir has already spoken about the each paper in detail, I will not be wasting much time as the time is short. And first of all, I really, to start with the gratitude, I really thank MAINS for inviting me on this very need of an hour topic, that is global economic order in post-COVID era. And for that, first of all, I really want to thank from the bottom of my heart, Dr. Nandkishorji Garg, who is an educationist and the philanthropist, and definitely it seems that, I mean, he has reached to a great politician and I think a multifaceted person. So I really thank sir for inviting me and making this MAINS reaching to a different height every year. And I thank Director General Professor S.K. Gargi, Director Professor R.K. Gupta, and I think from Shilpi's background and the I think Singla sir's Sanjay Mangla sir's background picture, it's really visible that I am there in MAINS only. So it's very nice to have a feel. Thank you both of you to making me feel that I am still in MAINS, presenting in the MAINS. Then I thank Dr. Lokesh Jindalji for your kind invitation to join me in this conference for the technical session. Along with that, I thank Dr. Sanjay Manglaji, who has obviously coordinated very beautifully this conference, and also S.L. Gupta Ji and Dr. Khurana and all the head of the departments. There are a lot of changes, and I really am not able to name everyone, but yes, all of them who are either the participants or presenters or the organizers, I really thank you. It's really so connected to be in MAMES after so long time. And I mean, according to this conference, as I have been into a lot of webinars, conducting webinars, the universities are inviting. And we are listening and also speaking a lot on this topic, that is COVID-19. It started, I'm not going to the starting phase rather, but yes, till now we are facing COVID-19 in three phases. So first was the shocking phase, in which we are really unaware that what happened, be it on the health side, from where the China, the virus has come, who has developed, or it has come naturally through animals, that was shocking, how to overcome, what to touch, we have to wear mask. So that was the thing, that was a fear, that how the world will go now, because it's not related to one community, one society, one place, it is really a world pandemic. Now, secondly, the second phase was the adaptation phase, that is, we were trying to overcome and we have been adapting ourselves to be in that particular situation, that we were aware that yes, government is introducing some means, or like the Arogya Setu app, or somewhat like anything, whatever we are getting the information, we were feeling so confident that yes, there are ways to take precautions, and we will be alive. We were seeing that India has done better than even the developed nations. So we were a little bit confident and adopting that particular situation. And now it is the third phase for which the conference has been organized, that what is the effect of COVID-19 on all economic, global impact of COVID-19 on, I think, every stakeholder. We talk about economy, it includes, be it like sir said, the migrant workers, or it is education, or it is manufacturing, whatever it is, wherever we touch, we are just surviving. Like Ratan Tata ji has said, that this 2020 year is the year of survival. If we are able to survive, I think we have, that is the biggest challenge we have overcome from this COVID-19. As per this phases, the presenters have presented in different fields or domains according to their specializations. And it was really not monotonous. I really congratulate MAMES to select such papers that they were not related to when we were hearing. They were from different sectors like tourism. We talk about health, we talk about education, we talk about mental stigma. So this is like, it was really interesting to listen different aspects of the presenters. And it is the platform rather that we learn also, and we share our views also. So that was a fear in our mind that what will be new normal. So from new normal to normal, it is again, we are moving from new normal. If we talk about someone is wearing mask was the odd time. Now, if we are not wearing mask, that is, again, the one who is not wearing mask is the odd one now. So that is, we always point out. So this is what we are moving from the new normal to normal in our the world, basically. Everyone is taking precautions. Even our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji focused on Atmanirbhar Bharat, right? We have to produce the commodities, basic essentials, and the other small things. Like we are boycotting the Chinese products now. So post-COVID effect is again like a thought coming in our mind that yes, we have to be independent. We have to be Atmanirbhar, as not wasting much time.
I'm feeling so good to see you on screen and to hear you. I'm sure we'll be connected in the future also. And I'm really thankful to both of you for your efforts, Dr. Eshal Gupta and ma'am. Please announce the moment of the day that we are waiting for. Dr. Eshal Gupta, I would please like you to announce the best paper award. Please do the honors.
Yep. Good evening once again to all. See, as per the discussion with the committee, we designed the four parameters or four variables to judge, to have the full transparency in the system. First parameter is theme presentation, means introduction or what is the topic. Second parameter is methodology, that is research methodology, including all parts of research methodology, hypothesis, objective, sample size, research design, and data collection, data size, and tools and techniques applied or used, what we understand from the presentation. Third is policy or implications of these topics in the society or in the government policy formulation and sectoral policy, etc. Fourth was presentation skills, like communication skills, way of presentation. So these four parameters and consisting total 20 marks or 20 scores. So out of these 11, all were good. I'm not saying anything is bad or good presentation, structured presentation also. But few papers are primarily, I don't know what we understand in the international conferences and national conferences. Once I got opportunity in All India Commerce Association in Bombay to have like the same role. And there about 150 papers were presented in one day, and the same criteria was given. So full day we presented. So they say this is not a keynote speech or not giving the awareness speech or just speech. This webinar or international conference is, should what I understand the background is research based, and they have presented their papers also, papers submitted for publication also. So research methodology also one important criteria. Out of this 11 topics or 11 papers, I don't know what is the truth or not truth, that is depends on the presenters. This serial number 6, psychological impact of COVID, presented by Dr. Ruchika, although she faced a lot of technical problems or technical glitches. And second, like this 5, mental stigma due to communication crisis and study of Delhi and Oman. See, these two papers, myself and Dr. Sharma could not differentiate which is better or which is the worst. So in my opinion and Dr. Sharma's opinion, both deserve the first prize. So congratulations
to the award winners,
Dr. Sangeeta Tripathi, and all the best to these presenters. And also others are also equally did well, but being a teacher, I don't know, is my problem or something, where research required, primary research or some data collection or tools or SPSS or MOS or hypothesis testing is, in my opinion, is one requirement for the research papers. I may be wrong also, I don't say, I'm always right. And also this Dr. Neeraj Mishra also gave the good presentation, but he's not given any award.
We are very, very thankful to you, sir.
5 and 6, serial number 5 and 6 deserve the first position. If Dr. Sharma, anything you like to add or something in this selection criteria or something?
Both we had a consensus and announced the result by Dr. S.L. Guptaji. And I congratulate all the presenters, because winning and losing is not the matter in this conference, because everyone tried their best. But it is a part, it's a format that we have to announce a result. So might be, I think, it's like 1 or 2, 3, 4 marks up and down it is there. And everyone, I really congratulate everyone. Everyone deserves a round of applause, seriously. And a round of applause for MAIMS for choosing such wonderful papers. So
thank you very much, ma'am. Thanks a lot.
These are all working papers, not analyzed properly, because COVID is still going on. So it is just a working paper till now, what is the impact on the economy. So I think it will be more data will be collected in these papers, and then can be presented in further conferences.
Sure, ma'am. I'm sure the presenters would have taken the valuable feedback from both of you, and they will incorporate all of that. I'm sure in the future they will do that. I take the privilege to thank everybody who's present, all the dignitaries, our guests, Dr. S.L. Gupta, Dr. Urvashi Sharma, our presenters, all the HODs. We have amongst us Mr. Jairam Mani Tripathi also. We have Professor Goyal. We have Director Mames, Director Mate, DG Sir, Dr. S.K. Garg, Govil Sir, Praveen Kumar Gupta Sir, all HODs. I may not have time to mention everybody. And most of all, our Department of Fed of Economics, Dr. Sanjay Mangla, who's also the conference convener. Thank you very much, everybody, for being part of the international conference, technical sessions, everything. Please refresh, take a cup of tea, and we welcome you for the valedictory now. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Okay, madam. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It's a pleasure to have you. Thank you very much for giving the opportunity for me sitting in Oman and judging the conference in India.
So it's a great achievement.
Sir, it is our pleasure, sir, completely.
Although sometimes this voice is a problem here, maybe connectivity problem or I don't know, some problem is there. But still, anyway, yes, we manage it. Anyway, we manage it. Okay, thank you very much, madam.